The second observation about the apostasy, a question of apostasy. For your information, of course, the methodology of interpretation in Islam has to go, number one, to the Quran, which is the source of sources. Second to that would be sound hadith. But since the Quran takes the priority, being in Muslim belief, the word of God verbatim, not just the inspiration in meaning, it takes priority over hadith also, and any hadith or saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, attributed saying, has to be interpreted only in the light of the Quran. On the question of apostasy, there is no single verse in the Quran that says you give an apostate punishment in this life. If you know one, correct me. Not a single one. Secondly, there is something opposite to that, and I did mention and allude to that earlier. There are numerous verses in the Quran that speak about freedom of conscience and freedom of belief. And as such, let's not just go to opinions of people, to the Quran itself, that everyone is entitled, even to his shirk, even idolatrous Arabs were recognized as a deen, according to Surah Al-Kafirun, Surah 109 in the Quran. Secondly, when you go to this hadith also, it is very important not to pick and choose. It is very important to bring all ahadith that deal with one subject and put it together. There have been ahadith that has been, in my view, misinterpreted to mean that anyone who lives Islam should be killed. In fact, some of the ahadith, if you take a broader view on this, actually connect that kind of punishment with the commission, in addition to apostasy, with some other capital crime, like the hadith about Uqal and Urayna. They apostated, but then they killed the shepherds and armed robbery and murder, so they were punished not really for their apostasy, but for joining that with another capital crime. Thirdly, there are several hadith also in the Sahihain, and that's in the two most authentic sources of hadith, that negate the notion of killing the person just on the basis of his belief that Islam is no longer good for him or her. In fact, it mentioned the story of a man who came to Medina to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he wanted to go back on Islam, to apostate, actually. أَتَحَلَّلَ مِنْ عَهْدِي. And the Prophet did not answer him in any way. The man went in safety, came back the second day, made the same request. The Prophet ordered no action against him. Some narrations of that hadith or version say that he came for the third day. But again, the Prophet didn't know anything. The man apparently was not intent or did not commit any criminal punishment. So it says he packed and left Medina. The Prophet didn't send anyone to catch him and bring him so that he faces justice and to apply the rule of Allah. He left him. He said, Medina, expel its impurity, just like the fire expel the impurities from the metal. He went in peace. He was left to go in peace. Now, the last part of your question, why don't Muslim scholars address that? They have addressed that. Even a small student of the students of the students of scholars like myself has written an article on that subject. It has been published already. And the same research paper was presented also in Arabic with some expansion in the last meeting of the European Council of Fatwa and Research. And I'm not the only one. Sheikh Rashid Rida have written about the same thing. Other scholars, contemporary scholars, also have the same type of view. So again, if we get to the proper methodology, then we don't look at the fact that the majority of scholars have interpreted that. They're not infallible, nor claim to be infallible. Remember Imam Shafi'i, one of the giants, who says, my opinion is right but could be wrong, the other opinion is wrong but could be right. I think we need to look at things really in greater depth, in more comprehensive way, but above all, using the proper methodology, and the absolute priority go to the main revelatory sources, the Quran, then the sound hadith, but opinions of the scholars can be evaluated. And Sheikh bin Bayya addressed the whole issue in terms of interpretation, in terms of the causality or effective causality, and also in the isqat, the application of ruling in a given reality.